Pattern matching is one of the most important features in Scala. It's so important that I may risk saying that it's not a feature of Scala, but the feature. It affects every other part of the programming language to the point where it's difficult to talk about anything in Scala without it being mentioned or used in a code example. You have already seen it. The match case statements, the partial functions, and the destructuring of instances of case classes. For this very reason, many things I'm going to talk about here you already know, so feel welcome to just gloss over them. I want to talk about them to be sure that I don't miss anything before I focus on the details I find the most interesting. One of the key concepts in early C++ was to replace the simple, crude structures of C with much more powerful classes. A struct was simply that, a data structure. A class expanded on it with methods, virtuality, the ability to inherit from other classes and to implement interfaces and so on. In no time we had deep hierarchies of UI widgets, managers, builders, factories and many other types of objects which were no longer really about data but semi-autonomous parts of the application. We started to develop object-oriented design patterns and discuss if a square is a subclass of a rectangle or the other way around. In all this, for some time we forgot that sometimes data is just data. But programs are there to handle data. Without it, all those fancy managers and workers, factories and facades, they have no reason to be. By marking a class as a case class in Scala, we state that it is designed to be a data structure. The Scala compiler will put some limitations on it, but it will also automatically enrich it with features that otherwise we would have to code ourselves. All fields of a case class are by default immutable and public. Instead of changing something in it, we can use the copy method and give new values as arguments for some or all of the fields. It will create a new entity with those new values for given fields and all other fields copied from the original one. A case class cannot be a superclass of another, but it can inherit from other classes and traits. It has an equality operator that checks the equality of underlying fields and, what may be the most important, a case class has the default implementations of apply and unapply methods, meaning that the case class can be used in pattern matching right away. The only real superpower of the apply is that it can be called without the use of its actual name. Instead of writing x.apply and the list of arguments, you can write x and the list of arguments immediately, and the compiler will know you wanted to call apply, but you were too lazy to write it down. Other than that, you can define apply however you want, but please don't. I believe there is value in keeping things simple, and so I will tell you this. Use the apply method as a constructor, and only as a constructor. Don't use overloaded constructors in the classes, use apply. Yes, you can define a method with this name for any purpose and put it either in the class or in the companion object, but if you care about the readability of your code, put it only in the companion object, never in the class, and use it only as a constructor. There are a few other ways you can use apply. For example, the collections library uses it often to retrieve data from a collection which superficially looks as if Scala traded the square brackets of more traditional languages for parentheses. And this use is popular enough that people understand it when they see it. But if you try to use it for something much different, you will only confuse other programmers and yourself in a few months in the future. But even when you stick to using apply as a constructor, you can still take advantage of the fact that it can take any arguments and return a result of any type. You can create a smart constructor this way. It's still a constructor, but it can do more. Depending on the arguments, it can return one of the subclasses or classes implementing a trait, which to the outside world will be known only as the entity of the superclass. The underlying logic is hidden. Let's say you create a trait and a few case classes and case objects implementing it. We have cut color, we have primary cut color, and we have also an object of all possible primary cut colors and then some more complex cut colors. And then you create a case class which takes one of those as an argument, and this will be the case class cat, and then we can create a few cats like this. So far so good, but one day your manager has a brilliant idea. Let's introduce Cheshire cat, which is invisible, so no color, and has superpowers. Obviously some changes in the design are needed, and here a smart constructor can be of use. So we change the cat from a class to a trait. We have a case class real cat, which extends that cat, that trait of a cat. And we have case object Cheshire cat, which also extends a trait cat, but has nothing to do with the case class real cat. Then we have apply methods, and then we have a few cats, and at the end also a Cheshire cat. From the point of view of the user of your code, almost nothing changed. It's almost as if cat were still a case class. The only difference is that now, somehow, you can call the catApply method without arguments, and it will produce Cheshire cat, which for all practical reasons can still be treated as a regular cat, unless we really need to look underneath. By the way, if you are interested in how smart constructors are used in Haskell, please take a look at this article by Mark Karpov. Okay, field traits. We have already touched this subject a little, now let's talk a bit more. Scala 2 doesn't have enums, they will be added in Scala 3, but field traits can be used for basically the same purpose and more. The field keyword means that all classes and objects implementing the field trait in question have to be defined in the same file. That in turn allows the compiler to check if a match case over instances of the field trait has all possibilities covered. Let's expand on the example from the previous paragraph. It will work and display "we're all mad here" in case the cat is the Cheshire cat, as it should, but during the compilation you will see an error. Match may not be exhaustive. It would fail on the following input, real cat. It not only tells you that you missed some subtypes, but even tries to give you a hint what is it that you missed. Real cat is the other possible subtype of the field trait cat. It is possible that you really wanted to write a match case which does not cover all possible subtypes, but it's highly unlikely. It's more possible that this is a mistake and using field traits is a way to prevent it from happening. Just add one more line, like this, and it will do the trick. Okay. In the next video, we will continue with the so-called unApply method, the opposite of apply, and the new type pattern. Thanks for watching. If you have any questions or want to contact me for another reason, you can just leave a comment below, or you can also find me on Twitter. See you next time.